Consider that as just part one of what it takes to be an artist. Part two is now, what am I doing with this? How am I going to get it there? And then part three is nurturing that, growing that, and making sure that, you know, that grows. But from where I sit, I navigate the entire space of being an artist from a more sort of philosophical, ideological view. And this is how I deal with the changes that happen to artists over time. I remember what music is, in its essence, the definition of what music is, and not the technical definition of it being defined as, you know, as rhythm and pitch delivered through sound, but as music as the word itself being derivative of the Greek word, the art of muses, the art of those who inspire, you know. So for me, music essentially is about inspiration, it's about feelings, it's about emotions, it's about the heart, it's about connecting with people, communities, and cultures. So from where I sit, the definition of music stems from there. So everything that surrounds it comes from that place. So instead of dealing with issues that affect the music industry as an artist, I try to navigate that space by saying that I'm dealing with the emotions industry. Because as an artist, that's what I'm doing. So I'm not in the music business, I'm in the emotions business. Which means I do consider the business side of it, but it has to start with the emotional part of it. Because as an artist, as a musician, that's where I need to be first. And I think that once you understand that, you start to connect with your audience and your fans, and you start to understand the listener and the end user, the market. You start to get a little bit more context as to what you're doing. And that helps you navigate the new challenges that you face as an artist in the 21st century. Dwindling sales, limited performance spaces for live musicians, digital distribution networks, piracy, etc., quote unquote piracy. So for me as an artist, those are the issues that I feel the 21st century artist faces, and personally as Zubs, that's the approach that I take to navigating those spaces. And I will share more experiences, I guess, as questions and answers come up, but that for me is pretty much the intro, as well as leave it. Thank you.
Okay, let's get it started. You want to be an artist? Well, welcome to the college for the artistically retarded. Face it, you haven't got it, but don't be downhearted, cause I'ma teach you all it takes for you to blow regardless. I know.
There's definitely a stratified scene where there are layers and tiers and stuff. But if you start seeing them in color terms, then you will definitely lose the plot. It's not a color thing, you know. The levels that exist are more about professionalism, access, and genre. That's what divides the music scene. That's why you get an underground scene. That's why you get an Afrikaans scene. That's why you get a gospel scene, Kwaito scene, urban scene, whatever. These tiers are generally about professionalism and the level at which you do your music. Because you can do it for fun as a hobby, and it can be an Afrikaans band, and you could be black. Do you know what I mean? Then you will find yourself not nominated for a SAMA, not booked for, not, you know, eligible for a Metro Award, whatever. Not because you're black, not because you're doing Afrikaans music, not, but just because it's a hobby kind of for fun thing you do on Sundays with your boys in the hood, right? Or you could find yourself investing heavily in it, spending a lot of time in it, perfecting it, garnering all the right networks around you and the right support around you, and blowing up, completely black faces in the band, all black,
all from Koka and Sira and doing incredible soki music, you know? And you get an award and you're an MK and, you know, everyone loves you in the Afrikaans community. Because I really genuinely believe that it's about access, money-wise and professionally-wise. That's what I believe. I think it might be a bit naive, but I think over the years what I've realized is that at the end of the day, people just want to know how serious you are about it, how professional you are about it. Can you execute? Does your music have the impact? Everything else kind of falls away and becomes a bit immaterial. And in terms of, like you were saying, like when you see it on Note for Note, does it mean that there's that them kind of people, and then there's the, you know, there's the festival kind of people? You need to stop thinking of it that way, because those guys are also at festivals, and those guys on festivals would, at any opportunity, jump at the chance to be on Note for Note, because it'll increase their access, it'll increase their reach. So never try to think of the scene as stratified beyond genre and professionalism. You know, if you're doing gospel, that's what's up. If you're doing rock, that's what's up. And another thing, just quickly before I finish, it's okay to be about one niche market. That's okay. You don't have to be part of a scene that you don't particularly resonate with. In fact, I think the future of music and artists is niche markets alone, where niche markets are gonna be fed and grown and united globally. So hip-hop artists like myself will only be on hip-hop radio stations, hip-hop magazines, hip-hop TV stations, hip-hop stages across the globe. And chances are, a gospel artist or an Afrikaans artist or a folk music artist will never ever hear of me, ever. Unlike in this day and age where you have like a Jay-Z hip-hop artist, and everybody knows of Jay-Z, you know? We have Andrea Bocelli, and everybody knows of Andrea Bocelli. I think we're getting to a point where the niche artists will have that kind of status and popularity and growth only in their niche market, and be able to make a living and a career out of that. That's just how it is.
Dragon Lion, try, so you bring it back for me.